The topic that I decided to write on is a topic titled African Legal Systems, a Misnomer? And so what I would like to do is to try and critique certain concepts, arising from this broad, topic of African legal systems, give you my own thesis and argument around this topic, and, highlight a number of issues which I think are relevant to consider in discussing this particular topic of African legal systems, and largely conclude by setting out what I see as a possible research agenda, which colleagues who are interested in exploring this topic further can then deal with. The reason I raised the question as to whether, the terminology African legal systems is a misnomer is largely because one must begin by asking whether indeed there is a legal system or legal systems that can be termed African. One must question what is it that ties together the various practices that we would like to term African, in order to see whether there is a coherent legal framework that can be termed African. Is it the fact that the people who practice these, systems are African in origin, or are there some unique features of the legal systems that would qualify them to be termed African? And my own view is that perhaps the time for thinking of these practices as African legal systems is now past, and that we should begin to think of other terminology to capture the concept that we have in mind. If you move on to the next issue, which is that it is quite common to associate what are described as African legal systems with tradition or culture, you then in fact compound the problem, because it suggests that there is some fairly static set of practices that are traditional in origin or exist in certain customs, and they continue to be that way, and they will always continue to be that way. Basically, if you juxtapose that against the reality on the ground, the position is that over the last century or so, there has been dynamic evolution of these practices, and it's quite difficult to pin down what it is that we would consider traditional in the way in which people practice these various practices. The dynamism arises from trends such as urbanization, Western education, changes in beliefs, adoption of concepts like gender equality. All of these issues mean that it is no longer, in my view, accurate to think of African legal systems as traditional or customary. This is, in my view, underlined by the fact that typically these practices are unwritten, and there has not been a framework for codification of those practices, so that, as changes occur, I think the practices themselves become nebulous, and there can be a lot of argument about, in fact, what exactly are these practices we are talking about. I then raise another conceptual question, which is the dichotomy often drawn between formal legal systems and informal legal systems. The suggestion there is that African legal systems are necessarily informal, and I think that this is not borne out by a close scrutiny of those systems. In many ways, there are formal practices around the delivery of justice using those particular systems. So I then, raise these things in order to support my argument that, in fact, to describe these things as African, as traditional, as customary, is a misnomer. My thesis is that the prism with which we should look at these practices is largely that they are community-based practices that exist side by side with state-based practices. The overall argument there being that these are practices that are grounded in community practices, they are grounded in particular communities. Those communities are quite diverse. Those communities are not static. In fact, they are very dynamic. And the critical feature that distinguishes these practices of delivering justice from what we typically think of as formal systems is that they are not backed by the force of the state. That to me is the critical difference. They are backed by communities. They exist side by side with state-backed practices. And I think myself that if you look at these from the overall conceptual framework of legal pluralism, then you will find there the explanation that would justify the continuance of these practices, which is that there are practices that for delivering justice that are backed by the state. There are other practices for delivering justice that are not backed by the state, both operate side by side and will continue to operate side by side for a very long period of time. Our constitution has endeavored to recognize the existence of these practices. But here I argue that that's not new. As Justice Sargon has said, way back in colonial times, the colonial governments also endeavored to recognize them. In recognizing them, both the Constitution of 2010 and the colonial government basically placed them in a secondary position to state-based practices. They did that using the repugnancy clause. And I think the repugnancy clause continues to endure, which suggests that to some extent, the Constitution is paying lip service to the concept of customary-based, of community-based practices. Because as long as you continue to evaluate the acceptability and validity of community-based systems for delivering justice on the basis of the repugnancy clause, then they will always continue to occupy a secondary position. In that sense, I don't really believe that it's accurate to refer to these systems as alternative. If you think really of what are alternative systems in the constitutional framework, it is systems like arbitration, all right, which are essentially systems that operate on the basis that as long as parties have chosen to go into that system, they are left to their own devices. And I think that in that sense, arbitration, for instance, occupies a superior position to community-based practices in terms of acceptance of the validity of the outcome of that system as justice. So that, I think, in my view, remains a serious issue that would require examination. I raise a second issue, which is that to the extent that the Constitution of 2010 introduces a second parameter for evaluating the validity of community-based systems as systems for delivering justice, they continue to further call into question the sustainability of these systems, even in the post-2010 constitutional framework. And that is because the paradigm that the Constitution of 2010 operates on is a rights-based paradigm. And the rights that we are looking at there are individual rights, all right? The Constitution has not yet accepted a group rights-based paradigm. Individual rights here culminate or achieve very, very sharp focus when you look at the whole concept of freedom of choice in the Constitution of Kenya 2010. And I'll just give you one example. If you look, for instance, at the debate that we are currently operating, seeing about the place of gender, women in the constitutional framework, if you juxtapose that against many, many, many traditional systems, then you can see that in fact, the constitution would not tolerate a community-based practice that would continue to operate on the basis that, for instance, those who are supposed to deliver justice will only be men, and women have no role or no voice in that particular framework, even if in that community, that is the framework for delivering justice. And so the constitution introduces a parameter which is basically to test the acceptability and validity of these practices against what the constitution sees as the ideal, which is a right, individual rights-based framework that in fact does not accept group rights as a valid framework for delivering justice. And I'll give you two examples, with the exception, for instance, of the recognition in the constitution of Islamic law, where group-based rights are clearly entrenched. I think no other community-based system would be able to persuade, you know, our judiciary that a group rights-based system for delivering justice does not in fact infringe on the constitution. So let me give you an example. If you take, for instance, the treatment that is meted out to, you know, female circumcision, what in our laws we now call, female gender mutilation. I don't know if what is the word, I forget what it's called, but it's now called mutilation rather than circumcision. You know of the court case in which a doctor went to court and said, well, look, if you're an adult and you have chosen to circumcise yourself or to get circumcised willingly of your choice, why should this be a criminal offense? And you remember the courts coming back and roundly saying it is a criminal offense. And that choice, even though you believe that your cultural practices support it, is contrary to our constitution. And that to me is a very good illustration of the subjugation of customary based practices by the constitution of 2010. And then I raise a third issue, which I believe is also worth looking at, which is that we operate on the basis of a justice system that is written. And so I raise the question, what is the place of criminal law, of criminal enforcement, of criminal sanctions arising from a community-based system which is not written in the constitution of 2010? So can you enforce punishments based on an unwritten criminal justice system? As you know, we are dealing with an uncodified legal system when we deal with these community-based systems. So what a crime is not written anywhere else. Now, if you punish people based on an unwritten code, would you not face serious questions that we still have not yet fully rehabilitated or accepted that this system can truly exist side by side with statute-based systems which are backed by the state? Notwithstanding the fact that there is an assumption that that is what the Constitution of 2010 is endeavoring to do. And so I want to sketch out a research agenda for those who are interested in this subject to look at. One is, how do you design a framework for the application of community-based justice systems that would truly be equal to a state-based system? And here I ask whether in such a framework, you would operate on the basis of an opt-in approach or an opt-out approach. Let me explain briefly what I mean. An opt-in approach would mean that as you do in arbitration, parties are free to choose whether to operate in that system or not. And if they choose to operate in it willingly, they are stuck there and they can't complain that it is repugnant to justice. Or Do you operate on the basis of an approach that is opt-out, by which we mean that you are born into that system? Maybe you are born a Luo, you are born a Taita, or you are born whatever it is that you are born into, but you can choose to opt out. All right, you can say, well, look, I was born a Taita, and by virtue of birth, this community-based system should apply to me, but I've opted out. And if you opt out, what is the future of that system? Because as more and more people opt out, then the system will collapse. What is the paradigm? How do you design such a system? And so for me, I think that this is something which is ripe for research. The second question that I think is ripe for research is whether this system can thrive in the absence of state backing, all right? In the absence of state backing. What do I mean by that? Essentially, how does the state, somebody raised the question, I saw it on the group chat, that these community-based systems did not have prisons, all right? And so if you did offend the community, they didn't lock you up in a prison. They derided you, they came and burnt your cowshed, or they expelled you from the community. You know, those kinds of sanctions, which were, quite effective. But in the constitutional framework we operate now, this would be considered self-help measures, which would be outlawed. So how do you operationalize this community-based system in the absence of state backing? And if you had to secure state backing, will you not be forced to accept certain paradigms that the state forces on you? And again, in my view, I think that this is ripe for discussion, for research. And I raise the third question and my final one, which is that a lot of these systems thrive in a fairly, harmonized society in which, for instance, you have one tribe, or for instance, you have, a society that is free of influences that are external to it. If you look at the Kenyan society today, mixed marriages, the idea that people can settle everywhere they want, increasing urbanization, exposure to education, what will be the running thread that will glue together these community-based systems that will enable them to thrive? So this, I offer these as thoughts, and I thought that for this particular seminar, there would be a starting point for discussion. So thank you very much for this opportunity, and I'm very happy to engage in further discussions, as the group, those who are participating, raise points. Thank you.